Hey, everybody. Thanks so much for joining us right here on The Right View. Tonight, we're joined by a guest from my home state, the great state of North Carolina. He's been with us on The Right View before. He proudly represents the 13th District and is now running for Senate so that he can represent all of North Carolina. Welcome back to the show, Representative Ted Budd. Ted, great to get you back on. Welcome back to The Right View. So we've had you on the show before. I just want to start by going over for our audience sort of how you and I kind of got here, because you and I feel like have a great relationship, and it was a very interesting journey to get here. We'd met before, then we both decided kind of simultaneously that we were interested possibly in running for Senate in North Carolina. And I just have to give you a compliment because you reached out to me constantly. You and I stayed in contact when I was trying to make that decision. And I have to say thank you for being so nice to me. You and I were just very cordial. But you didn't have to be that way. I mean, a lot of people are very cutthroat in politics. So I just want to say thank you for doing that. I felt like we had a good back and forth.
Well, look, I owe you a lot, Lara, because, look, we're both North Carolinians. Yeah. And when it comes to the U.S. Senate, we just want somebody who can win. That could be you. Right now, it's on me to win this, and I certainly intend to do so. But you and I can probably go back to 2018. So I was elected in 2016, and you know, it was all brand new for me. What was going on nationally with your father-in-law was going on in one district for me. There had been a redraw. I went and voted for someone in the congressional primary in 2016. And then a month later, two months later on the ballot, because they redrew the state. They opened up a brand new district with no incumbent right on top of where I lived, our farm right outside of Winston-Salem. I ran. There were 17 people on the ballot. And, you know, with presidentially, there was 17, or give or take, on the ballot.
Yeah, that's right.
I was a business guy that had never run for office before. Your father-in-law was a business guy, never run for office before. But let's fast forward, you know, navigating through that big primary. In 2018, it was a huge deal because it was a tough year for Republicans. I was in one of the toughest districts for Republicans in North Carolina. Nancy Pelosi had put me on her list of 33 members of Congress to eliminate. And nice. You came into the state. We hadn't met in person until 2018.
That's right.
You came in, you campaigned with me, and I barely had to say a thing. And then you talked, and you just did an amazing job. We beat Nancy Pelosi together by 6 points.
Love
so I was a fan then. And then, you know, fast forward a couple of years, you and I worked together 2020 to help get our senator reelected in North Carolina, to get your, you know, for your father-in-law, Donald Trump, to win North Carolina in 2020.
Which he did. He did. That.
Absolutely. And you did it in 2016. You did it again in 2020. But you're a pro. You're great to work with. And, you know, thanks for helping me in 18. And it was great to work with you in 2020.
Oh, well, thank you. By the way, Ted, I'm just going to throw it out there. We may have to do it again. And I'm not going to break any news here on The Right View. But, well, look, regardless of who is on the ballot in 2024, we have to make some major changes in this country. And we got to do it fast, because obviously we cannot sustain two terms of a Biden presidency. I mean, if we're all being honest, I don't think he can. I don't even know if he can get through one. But whoever is on the ballot in 2024, obviously, we're going to be down to help our entire family. I'm sure every Republican will be out campaigning. But I don't even know if we'll have to do anything, Ted, because it seems like Joe Biden and the Democrats are sort of doing it for us. I kind of feel like we could just almost sit back in a way and just let them continue to show people how terribly they could run the country. And I feel like it's going to be a great 22, and I feel like it's going to be a great 24. What is your prediction?
Well, the pendulum seems to swing in midterms back and forth and back and forth. I mean, we saw 2010, the reaction to Obama, who had been elected in 2008. Go back to 1994, the reaction to Bill Clinton and Hillary Clinton overreaching after having been elected and him being elected in 1992. And you see this massive swing towards Republicans. So the pendulum should swing our way, but we can't let it swing on its own and just sit back. I think you believe this. I believe this. We have to make it swing. We have to work. And even if they are as bad as we are seeing right now, we still have to put in X amount of work to make sure there's too much at stake. There's nowhere else to go. We are the safe country that people come to for freedom. Where do we go if this country gets ruined by the left? There's nowhere else to go. So we have to protect this country. I know your family stands up for that. President Trump did. I will. That's why I'm running. We just need somebody to win. And right now in North Carolina, it's on me for 2022.
Well, again, I just want to let people know, you know, you had decided that you were running for Senate, and then I was considering it. And I feel like, you know, in some ways we could have been rivals, but you and I still kept a very nice relationship. And then when I decided that it was not for me to do right now, perhaps in the future at some point, my kids, you know, you and I talked about this, my kids were just too young. I couldn't do it right now and be the kind of senator, should I get elected, that I would want to be for North Carolina, nor could I be the kind of mom for my kids that I feel like I need to be, you know, committing myself to something like this right now. I just think you're such a perfect fit for this Senate seat. You have been right down the line with good policies for this country, good things for North Carolina. I think that you are going to win this Senate seat. I certainly am going to be there helping you. I'm sure my father-in-law and so many in our family will be doing the same. But a lot of times I feel like whenever people feel like, oh, somebody could be a rival in politics, it gets really nasty. And I want to compliment both of us, Ted, because I feel like we both just kept it above board. We were both very cordial and thoughtful, and, you know, it could have gone a different way. So I just think we as a whole did great together. So I don't know what that says. I think that,
kudos to us on that. Kudos to us. But I remember calling you and I was like, look, somebody's got to do this. Is it going to be you?
Right.
And I remember I plan to be in the Trump lane, but I don't want to run because not only would you be in the lane with those great America First policies, you happen to have the name for the lane. Yeah. And look, somebody's got to do it. These are self-inflicted jobs. I don't have to do it. You didn't have to do it. We don't need it for our ego. There are easier paths out there for all of us, but our country's at stake. We just got to have somebody that knows how to win, and that could have been you. And there are tough days out there where sometimes, Laura, I wish it was you out there running instead of me. But look, it's on me now, not just to win it through this primary. We got to get to the real fight, and that is to beat the radical left. I talked to Democrats today in Raleigh, where I'm from NC State. And these were Democrats that say, I'm voting Republican. I didn't leave the Republican Party. The Democrat Party left me. You know, they have gone off the rails and over the cliff and are taking the country with it if we let them. Nancy only has a 5-vote majority, 5 or 6 votes in the House. 2 of those votes are from judicial activists in North Carolina. We just can't have that. And now we're going to get that back. We're a growing state. We're going to grow from 13 congressional districts to 14. And, you know, it's always going to be a court battle. It'll be a court battle, but judicial activism. We got to win this, and we got to win it for the next generation.
You know, North Carolina is interesting and slightly frightening to me in a lot of ways, because growing up, I feel like North Carolina was generally a pretty red state. I lived my whole life there until I moved to New York, and my parents still live there. My brother lives there. Like, all of my family is there. It feels very purple now, Ted. I mean, is it because, do you feel like it's because there have been so many people that have moved into North Carolina? It's a great place to live, by the way. Not that we want more people coming to North Carolina, but it's a great place to live. And it's sort of a similar thing with Florida. What I want to say to people, listen, the reason that North Carolina is such a great state is because, you know, there's good leadership in many respects there. We have a good thing going. Don't bring the Democrat policies, don't bring these liberal policies to North Carolina and ruin it. But it's kind of turning purple. I mean, I feel like it gets harder and harder, especially every 4 years for a presidential election, to keep it red. Man, I got to tell you, I was sweating in 16. I was sweating in 20. We got those both done. But it was kind of close. It was closer than I wanted it to be, Ted.
It really is. And you'll appreciate this story, having some roots from New York and a lot of connections there. So over here in Washington, D.C., I get in an elevator across from the Capitol, and in walks Chuck Schumer. New York. And after exchanging some cordials and introducing myself, at me. And of course, this is prior to the big race last year in 2020. And he looks at me over his glasses and he says, tell me about your state. We got to flip that seat that Tom Tillis was running for and make it Democrat. It's a seat that you and I helped hold on to, keep it Republican. But I said, Senator Schumer, I said, there are a lot of people leaving your state, coming to states like ours. And he just sort of looked at me over his glasses because he knows people are leaving New York and they're coming to North Carolina or Florida, where you are. And Look, I am grateful for these folks that are coming to North Carolina. But we have to realize when people leave an area because of politics and have made policies so hard to live life, please don't bring those policies and that voting habit with you. You got to think about what preserves freedoms, what preserves a low tax state. And the senator that you and I helped defend in 2020 was Speaker of the State House in Raleigh back in 2010, took over a majority and helped make a business-friendly environment, a family-friendly environment for our state that people from all over from the country are wanting to move to. Yeah. So we're grateful for our environment, and we want businesses to come. I just went to almost a groundbreaking yesterday for Toyota to have a next generation battery plant for electric vehicles, which is awesome. It's going to have 1,800 jobs in our state. They're investing $1.3 billion announced yesterday. Great. So that's going to bring a lot of people to our state, and we want that growth. But we don't want some of the baggage that comes along with the blue state politics.
Yep. And everybody needs to remember that. It's great if you want to move to a free state, if you want to move to a state with better tax situation, whatever it might be. Remember why you're moving there and remember why you left the place you just did. Always good to keep in mind. I want people, Ted, to know a little bit more about you.
Sure.
Is it true that you met your wife on a mission trip in the Soviet Union? I got to know about this. Is this a true story?
Yeah, absolutely. But you had to hear the whole story. I'll keep it tight. But so 30 years ago, this past August, of 1991, I go on a Christian mission trip to it's the Soviet Union at the time. It's the USSR. And Gorbachev was still president there. And two amazing things happened. When the buses opened the doors on Red Square, I thought that I'm going to jail. We were distributing Christian literature and medical supplies. We actually saw the bread lines. We saw just the despair in these people's eyes. And thought I was going to jail, but it was, that didn't happen. We were fine.
Fortunately, you're here with us today, Ted.
Yeah, here I am. Two things happened. One is the Soviet Union began to collapse, and the Iron Curtain came down that very week. Yeltsin was at the airport shaking hands. The Iron Curtain would begin to collapse. You would turn on and you would see the crowd in Red Squares. And then the second thing, Laura, is that I met my wife that week. And, people are like, wife in former Russia or in Russia, former Soviet Union, how's her English? And I go, it's fantastic. She's from West Virginia. And they're like, great. She is a coal miner's granddaughter from West Virginia. Amy Kate went to Marshall University, but she was on that same mission trip.
That's so cool.
We actually reconnected in Florida many months after that trip and started dating after that.
Wow. I mean, what a week for the world, really. But that's crazy that you were there when all that was going down. Very cool thing to experience. Very different, by the way, than Bernie Sanders, who went on his honeymoon to the Soviet Union. So it's a totally different situation here.
Very different. I don't have a lot in common with him, but maybe marriage, Soviet Union, except you didn't want a honeymoon there.
No.
Not at all. You don't want to take their policies, their failed policies. And now they're trying to bring it back. Who would, I mean, it's amazing what a generation forgets. And we have to, you know, that's why I supported some policy last week, co-sponsored a bill to make sure that the Victims of Communism Memorial Fund can create a high school curriculum to, if the teacher wants, they can teach this curriculum about the evils of communism, which has killed 100 million people.
I mean, and by the way, it is so true that some people, it's not just that they've forgotten, Ted, it's that they aren't even learning about this stuff anymore. And I think that's a really frightening thing to a lot of people. Look, I feel like that it was probably my generation was among the last that really got the true history taught to us. And then I feel like there was some kind of shift where they tried to kind of sugarcoat things or soften things, or I don't know if they thought people couldn't handle it or what, how it started, but now it has very clearly evolved into just kind of leaving out big parts of history or teaching a different version of things. And the thing about history, and especially the history of a country like ours, is that maybe it's not perfect and no one is saying it is, but you must learn from history. And if you don't learn about the horrors of communism and the fact that socialism has never worked in any country in which it's been implemented, if you don't learn from, you know, the past of a country like America, then you are doomed to, you know, recreate that same history. It will happen again in the future, likely. It's something I think about. My kids are very young, but this has to be something, as someone who is running for Senate, that must be top of your mind. The education in America, what the future looks like, how do we get people to learn about these things? Do you think we can right the ship on this? Because it makes me very nervous.
Well, I know that we have to try. And I know what also happens if we give up. About the beachhead of education, and you have a professor off in the distance who believes in socialism or communism, and then they get a tenured post at a university funded by, you know, a capitalist or somebody that had made some money and took some risk, and now he's funding the university where he graduated from, and now it's funding this chair, and then that chair teaches 100 students, 200 students a year, some of the professors, and then it begins to magnify over time.
Yeah.
That's essentially what Saul Alinsky would be for. I mean, you want to get these positions of influence, and that's the university, because you have such, I mean, people come in, parents are funding their kids to become socialist, unbeknownst to them.
Right.
They're sending them to, you know, what their alma mater was, perhaps, or some other good school, ostensibly, but they're being taught that which destroys our nation and destroys families, ultimately. And it has to stop. I think parents are starting to wake up. Donors are starting to wake up. And we realize it's terrible. Like, you could see it years ago, people start, and America's great. We love our, you know, little rebellions. We love our rock and roll. You know, we like our underdogs here in this country. But then you started to see the underdog, like with the Shea hats and the Shea t-shirts and, you know, a little, you know, the Castro hats and different things like that. And it just started to creep in because they thought it was an underdog. They didn't really know what it was. And then what was dangerous and destructive and killed 100 million people now became cool. Bernie Sanders, people thought he was cool back, years ago. And then you realize how destructive his ideals are. You know, when we saw that back in 2015, and now we know what they are. But we've got to realize that there's the 100 million people that died as a result of socialism.
Well, I feel like in some ways, in a large sense, that the tide is turning a little bit in our country. You look at things like parents pushing back in places like Virginia, you know, what just happened in that election recently. There is a bit of an awakening happening on a lot of different levels. I think parents now are more aware of what's going on in schools, whether we're talking about, you know, grade school all the way up through, you know, university. I think people are becoming more aware of what their parties might stand for. I think a lot of people are waking up every day and saying, I thought I was a Democrat, but maybe I'm a Republican because the things that are going on right now, I just can't get behind. I'm very hopeful for the future of America. I think that what you said at the top of the show is really important. Look, we could just sit back and let the Biden administration destroy America, let the Democrats who are, you know, basically controlling both houses in Congress have at it and take our country down, but then we would have nothing left. Sure, people would find a way to vote for us, but we got to get out there and fight. We have to educate people. We have to get people moving to the polls on Election Day in 2022. We are less than a year away from that. And I am hopeful, though, because I feel like, for better or worse, the things that happened in last year's election really have gotten a lot of people to wake up and realize what was going on in this country, and maybe they were sort of asleep at the wheel. Do you have a generally optimistic outlook? I would think you do about the future of America. I think we got to right the ship a little bit, but we could get there, right?
I'm a perennial optimist, even in dark days. Look, they say when you're going through hell, keep going. And yeah. If we're in hell right now, politically and the tone of the nation, let's keep going. And I know what happens, again, as I mentioned earlier, if we give up. But I know what can happen if we keep going, if we educate the current and the next generation and about the things that made our country great: life, liberty, the pursuit of happiness, the ideals that were discussed and the reason for becoming our own country in the Declaration of Independence, the framework of the Constitution, and how important that is, and even our the fact that we're created and endowed by that Creator with inalienable rights. I just think those are things that we need to be talking about, rather than hollowing out the core of our nation and letting us be a shell of what we once were. Let's make ourselves even greater. And so I'm an optimist, but we have to work to make that optimism a reality.
All right. I have two more things for you, Ted, and then we're going to let you go. I know you've got a lot going on, and we appreciate your time. Number one, is it true that you own or are part of a gun range? Because I have an idea that involves my husband, possibly my brother-in-law. I feel like we could do a real big fundraiser, get out the vote effort for Ted Budd. If that is true, I'm going to go ahead and throw my husband out there to come shoot with you somewhere.
There was faint hope back in 2016 that Eric would come by my business called Pro Shots. It's near Winston-Salem, but you'll love the name of the town. It's Rural Hall, North Carolina, not too far from Wake Forest University and Winston-Salem. But absolutely. So I bought this, a bankrupt. Who goes bankrupt in a gun range during Obama? But anyway, the previous owner did. In 2010, 11 years ago, it was a bankrupt, closed indoor gun range. And a local police department came to me and said, would you allow us to train here? We're driving our officers way too far away and taking them offline. And I did, my first customer for this place. And then the training captain, he looked at me and never underestimate the need of the public to have a safe place to shoot. And I said, you're telling me to open this to the public and not just keep it for the police training? And he's like, absolutely. And so we've made it our motto to helping our community responsibly enjoy firearms, 50 or 60,000 customers. Grateful for that training captain's advice. And it's been a great business to own back then. And still, I've got a great team that runs that and lets me do what I do up here. But it's a real privilege to defend the Second Amendment back home in that business and also up here in Congress.
Wow. Well, I love it. There was some hearsay about it, and now that I know, Ted, I'm just going to go ahead and offer up Eric Trump. I mean, we know that my husband, for people that don't know, by the way, is an incredible marksman. In fact, that was his Secret Service name, side note, was marksman. Mine was Marathon. We had to have M names. I don't even know if we're supposed to talk about that, but back in the day, because he really goes in and he wins all of these shooting competitions. He's incredible. So I think we need to get our heads together. We're going to come up with a plan. We'll report back to the audience about how you could get involved and all that. By the way, if people want to support your Senate run, Ted, where do they go? How do they find out more?
Just go to my website.com, T-E-D with one D and Bud with two Ds. So tedbud.com is the best place to go. And I will tell you, and you can tell Eric this when you see him next, that women tend to shoot better than men.
He tells me that too.
Ego. They listen better. Their muscles are steadier. They've got all kinds of advantages that us guys, and they never watched Rambo, so they're a lot better shots.
Oh my God! So are you inviting me to be a part of this then?
Yes, I am. Yes,
oh, good.
I am. Yes, I am.
Excellent. Okay. Right. Well, we'll get that. We're gonna get that one on the books. We'll let everybody know how they can contribute to that. So we're approaching Christmas. I gotta know, what does the Budd family do for Christmas? I know in our family, we have a tradition. We are always, by the way, in North Carolina for Christmas at my parents' house at Wrightsville Beach. And we always go to a Japanese steakhouse on Christmas Eve after we go to church. It is always our tradition. It's one of the few places open, by the way, in Wilmington, North Carolina on Christmas Eve. That is our tradition. And then, of course, we fast forward to Christmas morning. It's just, you know, a disaster now that my kids know what Christmas is all about. Just paper flying everywhere, toys. What does the Budd family do for Christmas? What are your traditions?
Well, if I was in Wilmington, and this does not answer your question directly, but if I was in Wilmington, I would be at the Saltworks.
Absolutely.
One of my favorite restaurants down there. Great hot dogs and lima bean soup. So maybe I'll see you and Eric down there sometimes. Amy, Kate, and I'll join you. But we start Christmas on the 23rd because her family grew up having to travel from one part of West Virginia to the other. So they would have, you know, there's Christmas Eve on the 24th. But because her name, her maiden name is Adams, they call the 23rd Christmas Adam instead of Adam and Eve. So we start with Christmas Adam on the 23rd. And then on the 24th, we celebrate with my parents and extended family. And then we go see those in West Virginia. So we try to pull it all together. And it's just a great time.
Got a lot going on.
Yeah, we do. We do. But anyway, it's great. And go back up into the cold country of West Virginia.
Love it. Well, an early Merry Christmas to you and the family. Please give everyone our best. We're going to obviously stay in touch with you. We'll have you back on the show. We want to hear how things are going. We'll get more info for people as things go along, but good luck. Thank you for doing this, Ted, because I couldn't do it right now. I'm behind you 100%. My father-in-law as well. You are going to be an incredible senator for our state. And we just want to say thank you for everything you do. We know that you're fighting the good fight in DC every day. So keep it up. And thank you again for joining us back on The Right View. And we're going to have you back very soon.
It's been an honor. Merry early Christmas to you and Eric and the rest of your family. You all are amazing. And I'm grateful to have you all behind me. God bless you all.
Amazing. All right. Congressman Ted Budd, thank you so much for joining us. And to everybody at home, as always, thank you. We will see you back here next time for more of The Right View.